Peter Bjarkman, welcome to you. Let me ask you first, how significant was this game?
Well, I think it has more symbolic significance than anything else. The fact that you have a dialogue between the U.S. and Cuba now after a half century, the fact that you have a dialogue between Major League Baseball and the Cuban Baseball Federation is important, because you can't start without that initial contact. But there are still a lot of obstacles in the road to any kind of opening of the doors that would allow Major League Baseball to have free access to the talent in Cuba.
Let me ask you specifically about Deyron Verona, the Tampa Bay Rays player who was the leadoff batter today. He was described as the first defector allowed to come back and play. Now, what about this? What's the significance
Correct.
Of that?
Well, up until a few months ago, none of the defectors were allowed to come back into Cuba. They were considered to be traitors to the system. And then there was a little bit of a thawing with the detente with Major League Baseball. And so a contingent of players went down there last December for a brief visit and to hold some clinics down there. But they did not appear on the field before the fans playing in a baseball game. So this is the first time this has happened. He was not a big star in Cuba. He left when he was very young. One of the reasons he didn't get really a major response from the crowd there was that he was not a star in Cuba. He was only, I think, about 20 years old when he left, and had only played one season in the Cuba, or two seasons in the Cuban League.
So is it possible that this warming of the chill here will lead to more Cuban players coming to the U.S.? Where do we go from here?
Well, the difficulty right now is that the players can only find their way to Major League Baseball if they defect, because they're not allowed by the Cuban government to legally emigrate out of the country to come and play professional baseball. So far, nothing has changed the position of the Cuban government. They are willing to talk about making some of their players available, but they want to control the ownership of those players, have them come back, play during the winter season in Cuba, play on the Cuban national team. And of course, once the players go to Major League Baseball, unlike the arrangement they have with the Japanese League, with Major League Baseball, MLB teams will own those players and they will be lost to Cuba forever. So this is a big stumbling block for the Cuban Federation. They want to keep their national baseball intact as much as they can.
Well, what about the continuing problems for Cuban ball players and baseball?
Well, I mean, there's a problem on both ends. Major League Baseball has had free access to those players who defect. They can sign them as free agents because we don't recognize any contracts that the players might have in Cuba. But it's been a big problem for the Cuban Baseball League because their players are defecting in great numbers. Over 100 players from their league have defected in the past 15 months. And so their system is being greatly weakened. The team that played today was against Tampa Bay was not anything like the national team of a couple of years ago. So this illegal flow of players out of Cuba is a problem on both ends. MLB has the embarrassment of some of these players they've been signing being brought out of Cuba by human traffickers, and that's a scandal lurking in the background that Major League Baseball does not want to have to deal with.
I don't know if you heard the president today in the interview during the game. He was talking about the example of Jackie Robinson and talking about the ability of baseball to bring social change. What do you think when you look ahead after a game like this?
Well, what I think is that you're going to have a long, slow process. As I say, the Cuban Baseball Federation and the Cuban government, with their entire economy, is in a very difficult position now. So they're going to have to compromise. They're going to have to make changes. They're going to have to open the doors to more dialogue, in this case with Major League Baseball. But what I don't see is, as a result of this game, suddenly in the next week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we're going to have an agreement where the Cuban players are going to come freely to the major leagues in large numbers. I just don't see that happening right away.
Let me just ask you finally about those players that have defected over the years. What kind of impact have they had on the American game?
Well, in the last couple of years, a major impact. You have Aroldis Chapman, who has been certainly the most dominant closer in Major League Baseball the last couple of years, now with the Yankees. You had Jose Abreu, a rookie of the year, set all kinds of offensive records as a rookie with the White Sox 2 years ago. You had the big splash that Yasiel Puig made. in Los Angeles. You have Yoenis Cespedes winning two home run derbies in the All-Star game and starring on a Mets team that played in the World Series last year. So a number of individual players have had major impact as individuals. The numbers, however, have never been, the numbers of players coming have never been as large as it might be if we didn't have the Cold War situation.
And conversely, what's been the impact on, or what is the state of play for the Cuban game today?
Well, let me give you two examples of that. The Cuban national team that was extremely powerful and was in the last World Baseball Classic in 2013 in Tokyo, that team, of the nine starters on that team, six have defected and are now playing either in the minor leagues or in the major leagues. They lost their entire outfield and infield from that team. And the Cuban League itself now, which was, I always thought, probably triple-A baseball in Cuba, is now a double-A at best, and they have some stars down there still, but they're also playing with youngsters who are not really ready to play at their National League level. So they've lost a tremendous amount of talent.
All right, and one last thing for baseball fans who don't know. Are there differences between the two, between the way the game's played in the two countries?
The biggest difference is in the structure of the game. The Cuban players play for their own home provinces, which would be states here. The league is made up of a team representing each province. There is no player trading. The players don't shift around because the teams are not corporate franchises. So there's great player loyalty to their province, and there's great loyalty of the fans to the players. The game itself on the field is pretty much the same, except the stadiums are older. They look like the stadiums here, minor league stadiums in the 1940s, most of them. And you have maybe a more flamboyant style of play. But other than that, the game is pretty much the same in both places.
All right, Peter Bjarkman, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, say it again. Oh.
Sure.
Peter, let me ask you one other question. I just wondered if today you saw any of the, the emotional reunions of some of these players coming back for the first time, or even the older ones being able to watch this, what your thoughts were in watching that.
Well, it's certainly kind of an eerie feeling. I've watched myself personally hundreds of games in that stadium in my many trips down to Cuba, and it's kind of hard to imagine a major league team on that field and to see the kind of friendly relations that you have between the two governments demonstrated by the two presidents sitting side by side. So the game had very much the feel of a kind of a ceremonial atmosphere. It wasn't like a normal baseball game in Cuba where you would have salsa bands playing in the stands and a much more flamboyant crowd. This was a crowd that was there by invitation, but it was a very eerie feeling altogether, I think.